And you've already cranked it down a bit, I see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. My last ask for this is. If you know it.
Why did it have to be a friend who chose to betray the Lord? And why did he use a kiss to show them that's not what a kiss is for? Only a friend can betray a friend. A stranger is nothing to gain. And only a friend comes close enough to ever cause so much pain. And why did there have to be a thorny crown pressed upon his head? It should have been a royal one, made of jewels and gold instead. It had to be a crown of thorns, because in this life that we live, for all who would seek to love, a thorn is all the world has to give. He was made to bear. And why did they nail his feet and hands? His love would have held him there. It was a cross, for on a cross a thief was supposed to pay. And Jesus had come into the world to steal every heart away. Yes, Jesus had come into the world to steal every heart away.
We could throw the guitar on there for you. I wonder what that would sound like. Yeah. keep the kids away from the fire.
I think that'll help.
Oh well, we'll just let it burn.
Now, somebody wanted to do Be Thou My Vision.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I can't play it, but I can lead it. Okay. If I can find the words. I wrote that one about 1870. Here we go. Ready?
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art.
Thou my best thought.
Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light.
Let's go down.
Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one.
Let's move up a little bit.
Riches I heed not, nor man's empty grace. Now my inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
We sang, let's do Great is Thy Faithfulness. Oh, that's my favorite one.
Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee.
Thou changest not.
Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Summer and winter.
Summer and winter, and springtime and harvest. Sun, moon, and stars in their courses above.
Join with all nature.
Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
I actually met a guy who knew Thomas Chisholm, who wrote those words. It was only written in like 1946. It's not that old of a song. And this guy, Thomas Chisholm, was absolutely poor. He lived at the level of poverty. And he was a member of the Gideons. This is in England. And you have to pay dues to be a Gideon. And Thomas Chisholm was so poor, he couldn't afford dues to stay. He was about to be kicked out of the Gideons because he couldn't pay his dues. And this man paid Thomas Chisholm's dues so he could stay in the Gideons. And that's the guy who wrote, "All I have needed, thy hand hath provided." I mean, wow. That was a guy who lived at the level of poverty, which I think is pretty cool. This one. Let me see him play it. All my fingernails are broken off, but let me see if I can play anyway. Handling all that baggage, luggage. No, I can't. Doesn't work, but.
Hear with my heart, to see with my soul.
Sing.
To be guided by a hand I cannot hold. To trust in a way that I cannot see. That's what faith must be.
When
when the universe fell from his fingertips. He decided he wanted some fellowship, but the man and the woman would not submit, so he made a better way. When the moment was right, he sent his own son, and he opened the way so that everyone could have hope and believe that when time was done, he'd be able to make us one. Saying, to hear with my heart, to see with my soul, to be guided by a hand I cannot hold, to trust in a way that I cannot see, that's what faith must be. Now I understand that there is a key. It's Jesus in me, a reality. That God is in Christ, and that Christ's in me. That with faith I see what is unseen. You sing.
To hear with my heart, to see with my soul, to be guided by a hand I cannot hold, to trust in a way that I cannot see. That's what faith must be.
That's what faith must be. Their final night, they bicker and they fight. Still they are slaves to men and not yet slaves to Christ. He would give up on words, too tired to speak. So he took up the towel and washed their filthy feet. The arguments just fade away. There is nothing more that they can say. The wordless lesson that will set them free. Tell me, how much more a servant could he be?
Sorry.
He took a loaf of bread, he broke it and he said, take this, my body, and remember me. He took the final cup, and as he raised it up, this covenant is new, my blood poured out for you. The arguments just fade away, and there is nothing more that they can say. The wordless lesson that will set them free. Tell me, how much more a servant could he be? He is the slave who always serves himself and makes of himself the final meal. Lived out in flesh so we could see. Tell me, how much more a servant could he be? He is the wine and bread, too much to comprehend. He leads us from his knees and serves us as a friend. In time they'd finally hear the message made so clear. Who is the greatest one? It is God's servant's son. The arguments just fade away. There is nothing more that we can say. The wordless lesson that can set us free. Tell me, how much more a servant could he be? How much more a servant? How much more a servant? How much more a servant could he be?
Thank you. got a couple more. Let's see if we can play this.
Clumsy words. The noise of what we often say is not worth being heard. When the Father's wisdom wanted to communicate his love, he spoke it in one final perfect word. He spoke the incarnation, and then so was born the Son. Jesus, he needed no other one. Spoke flesh and blood so he could plead and make a way divine. And so was born the baby who would die to make it mine. And so the Father's fondest thought took on flesh and bone. He spoke the living, luminous word, as once his will was done. And so the transformation that in man had been unheard took place in God the Father as he spoke that final word. Sing, break. He spoke the incarnation, and then so was born the Son. Word was Jesus, he needed no other one. Spoke flesh and blood so he could plead and make a way divine. And so was born the baby who would die to make it mine. And so the light became alive and manna became man. He stepped into time so we could understand. He spoke the incarnation, and then so was born the Son. His final word was Jesus, he needed no other one. Spoke flesh and blood so he could bleed and make a way divine. And so was born the baby. And so was born the baby who would die to make it mine.
That song gets higher every year. let's see. Let me do one more and then we can do our s'mores, which I know you're all anxiously waiting. If I can remember how to play it. Let's see. Hold on, just reestablishing the neural pathways. I've written 450 songs. It's hard to remember them all. There it is.
My man.
This is a song I wrote about my father. And I think it applies to all of us in one way or another. It's a song about the fact the way that God uses our wounds. Uh, my dad was a doctor, and he was a very good doctor, but because of what he did, he wasn't home a lot, and so I sort of grew up with this, I mean, a lot of us have this, the father wound, they call it. And my dad would leave in the morning to go make early rounds before any of us were up, and he would come home at about 7:30 or 8 at night. And my mother insisted on us waiting for him for supper. So I grew up eating supper at 8 o'clock at night. My dad would come home, and he was always tired, and he was almost always angry. He was a high moral grounds person, and people like that tend to be angry a lot. So he would come home sometimes, and we'd always stop what we were doing and get up and greet him at the door. That was a different era. My kids barely look up from their video games when I would come home, but we would stop what we were doing and we would go greet my dad, and he would go back into his study and lock the door. Of course, supper was always ready, you know, when he got there. And since I was the youngest, they would send me to get him. And I had this really clear memory of trying to get his attention, and I have no idea what he was doing because he always locked the door. I don't know if he was taking a drink or if he was just decompressing. Maybe he was punching something. I don't know what he was doing. But I used to wiggle my fingers under the crack of the door to get his attention, or draw. Sometimes I would draw pictures and slide them under the door. And years later, my wife and I are in counseling, which is where people like that, who grew up like that, end up in counseling a lot. And my counselor, I told him that story, and he looked at me, and his face lighted, and he said, "I just figured out who you are." I said, "Wow, I need this information. That would be a good thing to know." And he said, "You're still that little boy." He said, "Do you realize that's how you communicate with everybody? You're always trying to get people's attention, right?" And I realized that songwriting is just basically this. And what I realized was that, you know, God uses everything, right? Especially our wounds. I tell people, if you think, you know, isn't God lucky because I'm on his team, I say, think again. Because what he uses is our foolishness and even our disobedience sometimes, but certainly our wounds he uses. I mean, think of Jesus. What does he use? He used Jesus' wounds, right? In a sense. But anyway, that's where this song came from. If I can remember how it goes.
Was a doctor who would come home late at night with his soul so bruised and bleeding from his unending faithful fight to keep a hold of kindness in a world that isn't kind, to hold out the hope of healing to his hurting humankind. And he'd flee back to his study, to his bookish quiet place, with notes and books and journals to wall in his special space. But then he'd lock the door from things that cannot be locked out, and his youngest son would starve for what he would always do without. But it was meant to make me who I am, and for all these many years, still the little boy down on his knees, full of hope and full of fear, calling underneath the door, "This is me, it's who I am." For we love the best by listening when we try to understand. Desperate stubby fingers pushing pictures neath the door, and longing to be listened to by the man that I adored. Inside, someone who needed me just as much as I did him, still unable to unlock the door that stayed closed inside of him. strange the way we tend to flee from what we need the most. That a father would lock out his son when his heart would hold him close. But our wounds are part of who we are, and there is nothing left to chance. And pain's the pen that writes the songs, and they call us forth to dance.
Man, excellent.
Yeah. We can talk about that if you want to. Or we can do s'mores.
Thanks for sharing that.
What's your dad's name?
My dad's name was William.
William.
Yeah. William Carr. Come on. Yeah.
Come on. I might have lined some over here.
Oh, good song. Good song. Good story.
So anybody, what was your favorite thing today and your least favorite thing today?
Enjoy going on the boat across the Galilee. You know, it's just amazing.
Wasn't it? Isn't it something?
Oh my goodness. The sunsets, though.
Is David here?
No.
David said that was the best boat trip he's ever made. Just in terms of weather and timing and sunset and seeing the other people fishing. The guy holding up the fish, how cool was that?
Yeah.
I had no idea that there were fish that big in this lake. Yeah. Got there, we could just go through them.
Yeah.
And it's actually easier to make a list of things that didn't happen in Capernaum. Because everything happened there. You know, so much stuff happened there. But it's a real place. It almost hit with a bow and arrow from here.
Yeah. It has a reality in it. In spite of all the loving work that the religious orders have done with places like the Beatitude Church and so forth, to see the real life in the ground, the remnants.
Yeah. Gorgeous. Well, where else did we go? Chorazin, Capernaum,
Beatitudes.
Oh, Beatitudes. Oh, that's right, Beatitudes. Yeah. The coffee's real good at the Beatitudes place. I wonder if it was as good when Jesus was there.
I don't think the cappuccino machine worked quite as well.
Really?
I think so.
Might be my favorite place today.
Mm-hmm. What, this?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, for a lot of people, the bonfire is the bonfire, and one of the things we have left to do is we're going to leave you in the middle of the wilderness.
Oh.
And that, no kidding. That tends to be some people's favorite time. I mean, it's like being left on the moon. I'm not kidding. We didn't come down the road from Jericho. We went around the other way up through Samaria. So you haven't seen it, but you'll see it. When we go to Masada, you'll see it. I usually stay with Kamal in the bus. I don't want him to be lonely, so
yeah.
You're welcome.
Seeing the houses, I never made the connection between, in my house, like many. Many rooms.
Yeah.
That was a connection I'd never made before until I saw all those rooms in the house.
Yeah, and the American, there's a mansion waiting for you, all that bull crap, you know. The idea is, it's minnow. There's a place for you. I've got a place that's just for you. It's not a mansion. You know, it's a place. And that, to me, that's more
intimate.
That means more. I've got a place for you. You know?
I don't need a mansion.
Yeah, a mansion's almost like prosperity gospel.
Who wants a mansion anyway?
Yeah.
You gotta clean it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Feed it.
Yes.
No house cleaning.
Hmm?
No house cleaning in heaven.
Yeah. Well, I had a professor explain this to me a long time ago. I'm sure I don't think I still understand it. But the idea that heaven is an eternity. Heaven isn't time on and on and on. Mm-hmm. Heaven is no time. He used to say, we all enter heaven at the same time. Because what happens when you die, you leave time and you go into, you know, heaven is no time. And it's an eternal presence. Heaven is like this. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The sacrament of this present moment, it's that forever. Except forever is not the right word. There's not a word for it because we can't understand what it would be like to be outside of time. But I love the idea. If you ever want to mess somebody up, say, hey, we all enter heaven at the same time. I mean, do you think that's a cool idea? Who wants to sit on a cloud for all eternity? I don't. But being eternally present with God, you know, the, I don't know. I'll go with that. I'm looking forward to that. And it's way better than we can imagine, I guess. If we could imagine it, it's not heaven. So what are we doing tomorrow, Susan?
Ron.
We have Sicily of Philippi. Yes.
Oh, that'll
we
be
have Phil Dan.
That'll be
we
fun.
Have Golan Heights.
So we're going to look into Syria tomorrow. Yeah. So you can tell your friends that, like, you've tweaked Fade in the nose.
I know he will, he'll give you more of a feel for just the military side of things at that point and that part of stuff. The more, some of the modern stuff along with
the... I can see Syria from my tour bus.
I was in Lebanon today.
Really? Wow. What was that like?
I don't know. It's just my fingers were off through the fence.
You guys help yourself. There's sticks up here.
I don't
There's
think
marshmallows.
Don't? Yeah.
Okay. All that stuff. Do you want
me a marshmallow?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I don't do s'mores.
You want a marshmallow too?
I know, but you eat chocolate.
I can make my
I've
own.
I've been eating chocolate all day. Thank you.
Take advantage of the day.
I went to Kroger's and bought this stuff to bring it over. And the lady says, oh, it looks like you're going to have a bonfire. I go, yeah. On the Sea of Galilee. I'm in Nashville. Yeah, on the Sea of Galilee.
They think this is where Jesus cooked the fish for his friends.
No, it's on the other side.
On the other side?
It's on the other side. This is the pagan side. This is the bad side.
Okay. Like,
that's the good side over there.
They had hog roast over here.
Yeah.
And?
Huh?
I'm good.
I do. Because that's where they went back. You know, there's a... I don't know if you've ever tried to trace the post-resurrection period, but he tells them, like in Matthew, the only word they get from the angel is, go back and I'll meet you in Galilee. So they got a 10-day to two-way, I bet they made it in 10 days.
Right?
They go back to Galilee to meet Jesus. And then I'm not sure exactly how long a period of time they're here, but that second miraculous catch fish, and that's right, and that's also Great Commission. I used to think the Great Commission happened at the same time the Ascension happened, but that's two at a time. So they're on a mountaintop somewhere up here when he gives them the commission. And then they go back to Jerusalem, and the Ascension happens on the Mount of Olives in Jerusalem.
That's fish roasting on wooden sticks.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, we've done it. Okay.
We'll make it work.
Just don't stick the stick in. Just the marshmallow.
I just tried to figure it out because I had to. But I had never looked at that, and it actually, frankly, never occurred to me.
Yes, I am.
But the first thing they do is he meets them back up here at this lake. I mean, you know, that's the second miraculous catch fish in John. Right? They're back here. And Matthew is really clear. The Great Commission happens on the top of the mountain north of here in Matthew.
My face is done.
But that's not when the Ascension happens.
Well, then, Mark, it's going to be Luke, the Ascension takes place in the Mount of Olives.
In all the accounts, the Ascension takes place in the Mount of Olives. But it's not the same time as the
that's
commission.
Not so well, is it?
Mark doesn't mention it.
Mark doesn't talk about it.
He does? Yeah. Okay. No, Mark leaves him standing there afraid.
Yes.
Yeah.
Bewildered.
Yeah.
Here with the stick.
Which is an interesting discussion in and of itself. Yeah. Well, that's interesting to try to do, and it's really interesting to do the chronology of Passion Week.
Yeah.
because that's really hard to make work. To put
that's some creative sticks.
Yeah, your stick's gonna fail too.
Did y'all make those sticks?
Yes, we did. Might be a badger butt.
Somebody something like a chocolate bar to me.
Are those rubber bands? Some of you guys man up and get your hands close. I'm a musician.
We can't wait for the fire to die down.
You get a stick? You're supposed to do it with an unwound coat.
That's amazing.
Well, the guy on the boat said those fish get to be even bigger than that one.
Oh,
I had no idea. That's a big fish. And they're little, almost like sardine fish in this lake, too. I've seen those, but I've never seen... That thing was huge. What about Capernaum? You still processing it?
Yeah.
Incredible.
I thought seeing both archaeological sites reinforced each other, comparing the two synagogues, comparing the insular houses, to see that these are village patterns repeated over the landscape as ours are today, and it just gives a real idea of the life they live.
I was going to make a list for you guys of all the things that happened in Capernaum so that we-